Hello everyone, I am Imanol Fernandez from Igalia. As you may know, we've been contributing to the WebXR WebKit implementation focused on DOM, OpenXR and standalone VR browsers. And today I'm going to talk about the main challenges from WebXR browsers in different areas such as rendering, UI and privacy, and comment on a high level how we can address them. Let's start talking about rendering. The impact in VR is that we need to render everything two times, one camera for each eye, left and right. Both cameras are separated by the interpupillary distance, which is about 6.4 centimeters. In addition to rendering for different views, we also need a high field of view in VR. This is achieved using a lens in small mobile displays. If we didn't have a lens, we would need a huge display such as the classic DOM screen. The lens is a cheap solution but comes with some side effects, because there is a physical distortion. If you see a square through a lens, there is a distortion, especially in the borders. This is technically called the pink cushion distortion. In order to solve this, we need an extra render step, which consists of applying the inverse barrel distortion. This render post effect is able to compensate the physical distortion from the lens and let users see a correct image. In the picture below, you can see a frame with barrel distortion applied that users will see correctly after each display through a lens. Another side effect is the chromatic aberration. Using a lens causes color rays to have different focal lengths, making the borders between colors visible. In addition to the barrel distortion, we also need to apply a chromatic aberration fix post effect. In the image, you can see what users will see if the post effect is not applied. The borders between the four rectangles have some color glitches instead of being precise. In VR, we have a hard limit in the render path budget. Modern standalone devices have a 120Hz frame rate, and we need to guarantee that the motion to photon latency is within around 11 milliseconds frame time budget. This latency is at the interval between reading the sensors from the device and displaying the final image in the display. If we fail to render frames on time, users could feel motion sickness or nausea, and we don't want that to happen. How can we address all these render handicaps? It requires optimizations on both the internal browser engine and the content render engines, such as 3JS. This image shows a high-level view of all the steps when rendering a 3D scene. Frustum cooling, shadow mapping, rendering opaque and transparent geometry in the correct order, and the distortion and chromatic aberration post effects at the end of the frame. Let's see how to optimize it. The easy solution is the multi-camera approach, which is basically counting the render function two times, for the left and the right eyes. This is very easy to implement, but is not a good solution. Imagine that the frame time for one camera is 10 milliseconds. If you can render two times, the frame time will be duplicated, making a total of 20 milliseconds, which is far away from the target. A way to improve this problem is the multipass approach, which works by extracting out eye-independent render steps. There are render steps that we only need to process once, such as the frustum cooling, shadow mapping, physics. For example, in order to calculate a single frustum cooling, we can place a point below the left and right cameras and create a frustum that covers both at the same time. This is a nice optimization, but we can improve it further by using a single pass solution. We can expose the multi-view OpenGL extension, which allows developers to submit render commands for different views in a single pass and render everything into texture arrays. This is a great optimization for CPU-bound applications, which is the typical situation in WebXR. The multi-view extension injects a view ID in the shader, and by using it we can select the related data for each view. In this example, the view ID is used to choose the correct left or right projection and view matrix. We could have also used it as a uniform array index. Multi-view is a CPU-only optimization. Even if we submit all the render commands in a single pass, we still need to render all the 3D content for each view in the fragment shader. WebXR can also be GPU-bound. It's less common than CPU-bound though. For this situation, the browser can expose foveated rendering. This is a frame buffer extension that mimics how the retina from the eye works. The frame shader is run with maximum quality in the center, but the quality is reduced in the borders, reducing the amount of times the frame shader is called. Users can optionally enable this feature when creating a WebXR session. We've seen how to optimize CPU and GPU bound applications, but this is not enough. Imagine there is a bottleneck due to garbage collection, loading textures, audios, or other assets, or simply because in a complex content we can't catch up with the target frame rate. Asynchronous reproduction is a render technique invented by John Carmack that, when there isn't a frame ready on time, it's able to take the previous frame and reproject it using the latest post information from the device. This is not a magic solution, because the only way to reproject a static frame or image is by adding black borders, but it's a good enough solution to guarantee stability and reduce the risk of producing motion sickness. By using the asynchronous reproduction, we have an stable motion to photon latency, so the job of the browser is to optimize the internal render path as much as possible in order to have less stale or reproduced frames with black borders. It's important to reduce the number of bleeds by using high performance surfaces and swap chains such as iOS Surface on Mac and iOS, or a hardware buffer on Android. Frame prediction is another important optimization that it's already compatible with the existing WebKit OpenXR implementation. You can see two profiles in this slide. Without frame prediction, the content process have to wait for the VR compositor to complete the current frame, increasing the idle times and reducing the frame rate. By using frame prediction, we can render one frame ahead while the VR compositor is displaying the latest frame, which reduces the idle times and improves the frame rate. This is a summary of all the most important rendering optimizations. I'm going to change topic and talk about the UI challenges now. The main complexity is that the UI needs to be redesigned for VR, because we can't use the existing 2D UI if we want to provide a good immersive experience. And this is something that is not available. For example, anyone using Chrome as their base, like Oculus, needs to do some heavy lifting to build their own VR UX. In this video, you can see a general purpose VR browser we have built using WP on Android devices. VR UX is an uncharted terrain, so providing a good user experience requires thinking about the UI in a new way and doing lots of tests with real users. You have to decide the most ergonomic VR keyboard placement, how to interact with multiple flat or curved virtual windows, the transition between the browser window and WebXR, and other UX-related things. This leads to this diagram of components in a standalone VR browser. We have the VR compositor, which displays frames and applies the distortion, the content, hopefully running a multi-view render path, and the UI process, which combines a custom 3D UI plus the web view engine. This looks good, but there might be a quality issue with some components from the browser, such as the text or media playback. Let's see it with an example. Imagine you want to render a 4K video on the half of a 3D VR scene. VR display still don't have the retina quality due to the high level of view required, so the quality can be equivalent to only 1K on some low-end devices. Here is where the problem lies. If you render a 4K video on half of a 1K frame buffer, it only ends with 512 pixels, and the distortion correction post effect only uses this small number of pixels instead of using the original 4K video size, affecting the general quality. One solution to this problem is using VR compositor layers. Instead of sending triangles to the VR compositor, we can send a list of layers, each one containing the texture with the original quality. This way, the VR compositor can do a better job in the distortion and chromatic aberration passes, use sub-pixel precision, and sample the textures once instead of rendering them first into a frame buffer and then sampling the content again for the post effects. There are different types of layers. For example, the quads and cylindrical ones are the ones used for the UI, cube maps used for skyboxes, rectangular layers are the ones used for media playback, and the projection layers are the ones used for general 3D content such as the beam and the 3D controllers. Finally, the privacy is the other topic that is challenging in WebXR browsers, as they can expose new kind of data and input from users and their surroundings. One type of data that's becoming more available is hand tracking, which exposes articulated hand poses from users as an alternative input to using a remote controller. This comes with several risks. The hand poses could be used for fingerprinting, tracking the gender or age of users, or detecting medical problems such as Parkinson. Some solutions are being discussed in the specs, and one important thing is providing a solid explicit consent and permission system. Another workaround is trying to round the hand poses in order to reduce the fingerprinting possibilities. A new API that's coming is eye tracking, useful to look around in VR without having to move the neck. The amount of privacy risks if this is exposed is crazy, from detecting personality traits and cognitive processes to several medical conditions, including drug consumption. A potential solution is to never expose the raw values and only use them internally in VR transform matrices. But there is still a risk of user making differentials between matrices and trying to estimate the eye tracking values. Hand tracking and eye tracking affect the VR side of WebXR, but AR also introduces new risks. If we're understanding exposed, a malicious page could use it to detect common objects and track the location without using the GPS, or estimate the level of your income based on the size of your room or house, and similar things. All these risks are still under discussion in the AR side of the WebXR spec. Okay, so this is the end of the presentation. In a summary, implementing a fully immersive WebXR browser has some complexities, but I like to think about them in a positive way. Making a good WebXR browser pushes the internal render path of the browser, the render path of the Web3 engines, WebGPU in the future, improve the privacy and the permission system. So the browser is going to be improved for other non-XR rated use cases too. Thank you so much for your interest. I hope that you like the presentation. Let me know if you have any questions.